The Stoa is a digital campfire where we cohere in dialogue about what matters most at the knife's edge of what's happening now.
All right, everyone. Welcome to the Stoa. I'm Peter Lindbergh, the steward of the Stoa, and the Stoa is a place for us to cohere and dialogue about what matters most at the knife's edge of this moment. And today we have John Robb, part of our Sensemaker in Residence series. And John is American author, military analyst, and an entrepreneur, and author, curator of a popular Patreon page called the Global Guerrillas Report. And this is a sense-making series on networked tribes. This is the second part. And today's theme is going to be on war. So how today's going to work, John's going to share his thoughts today. And then we're going to have a Q&A. So if you have any questions for John, anytime he's speaking, just write in the chat box. You can write it in right now. And I will call on you. You unmute yourself and ask your question to John. If you'd like me to read it on your behalf, just indicate that in the chat. This will eventually go on YouTube. So after the hour mark, we'll stop the record button and then we'll break into groups for 30 minutes and we'll have a kind of post-sense making session. So that being said, I didn't know you were in the waiting room, John. I was waiting for you. The black ops fooled me. So you can unmute yourself now and then feel free to launch us.
Yeah, black ops is harkens back to when I was in counterterrorism. I did that for about 7 years. It's a tier one counterterrorism unit. So I was flying in that and I was mostly a smuggler, basically. I got people in and out. And you know, if you had to get people out of a dangerous situation, I would go in, maybe, you know, embassy family or whatever. We could get them out of a place without people knowing that we were doing it. So I kind of kept that, kind of sticks with you for a while. What I like to do today is go over a lot of the terms and a lot of the concepts that I use to make sense of what's going on. I have, you know, three different phases of how, you know, modern conflict has developed. Started with the open source warfare of the 2000s, open source protest of the early teens, and then it moved on to weaponized social networks. With the election in 2016. And there's a bunch of terms associated with that. And now it's moving into a network tribalization phase. So getting more and more cohesive, getting more and more coherent, more dangerous as it develops. You know, prior to the 2000s, most guerrilla warfare thinking was, you know, developed in the 30s and 40s and 50s. Some innovation was done on that in the 90s with fourth generation warfare. Fourth generation warfare focused on the collapse of the nation state post-Westphalian, that the nation state was ill-suited for survival in a globalized environment. And that nuclear weapons kept conflict at the guerrilla level, prevented, you know, large-scale conventional war, and therefore all the conflicts would devolve down to these guerrilla wars. What I saw in 2000 in Iraq was an open-source insurgency, and let's go over some of the terms associated with that, is that the problem in Iraq for the guerrillas was that, you know, how do you face the United States, you know, purportedly the, you know, the most powerful military in the world, unlimited resources, willing to spend, you know, $3 billion a month on the war, on the counter IED effort, and trillions on the conflict. They did it through decentralization or hyper-decentralization. In Iraq, there were about 70 different guerrilla groups operating at any given moment. Very small, didn't agree with each other at all. There were nationalists and there were pro-Saddamist and anti-Saddamist, and there were a bunch of different flavor of jihadis. And what happened is it's largely due to the presence of the telecommunications networks that were wireless ones that were put in place almost immediately after the war, that conventional portion of the war ended. They went up in months, you know, blanketed the whole country with telecoms. Is that they developed an open source mechanism right out of open source software. And I assume everyone's least familiar with that. In the case of bringing it to the physical world, what kept these groups together was a single idea, really, really simple. The plausible promise. It's a goal that all of these different groups, even with all their diverse motivations, can agree on. This case, it was kicking the United States out of Iraq. And this plausible promise is typically demonstrated through a single act. In the case of a protest, say in Egypt, that was started in Facebook and Twitter, boom, if they were able to hold the street for a certain period of time and a lot of people showed up, that showed that it was plausible, that it could have legs, it could actually succeed. And once that occurred, all the groups joined in. All right, so the plausible promise is really simple. It defines where the group is going, how they develop over time. It puts a lot of restrictions on the group and restrictions on the protest. In the case of, say, Puerto Rico, when they were kicking out the governor, I mean, all they really could do is say, you know, Ricky renuncia, you know, Ricky, you know, had to leave office, that the governor had to leave. And that was the only thing that kept all of these, you know, diverse elements focused. That puts limitations on the type of leadership you can have in an open source and, you know, context in the physical world, is that the leadership is conditional. It only is given to anyone who advances the open source insurgency, open source protest towards the goal. The moment you try to fork it, the moment you try to take it into a different direction, like in Egypt, they tried to, the leaders tried to take it towards renegotiating the constitution, and they were immediately shunted to the side. Everyone just ignored them. What they wanted is, how do we move towards getting rid of Mubarak? That conditionality is very, very powerful, but that means leadership doesn't work in the traditional way. It's really limited to what the goal of the protest is. Now, how do the open source insurgencies and open source protests fight? How do they, you know, mount attacks in the case of Iraq against a bigger foe? Is they do it through systems disruption. And one of the biggest, it's kind of like sabotage, but amplified. It's like amplified 100-fold, two orders of magnitude more important, because all of modern life is tied together systemically. And it's any disruption of that can sweep through these network connections and cause amplified damage. And so I worked on a whole group of terms associated with systems disruption. One of the more important ones was, you know, the system punct. It's finding that point in the system that if you knock it out, it's usually not defended that strongly, and you knock it out, you can cause cascades of failure that sweep between systems, and you hobble the opposition. And the more you disrupt the environment, the more more people that join your insurgency. The more disruption there is, the more people rely on these insurgent groups to get through the day, survive in that environment. Another term that's interesting is stigmergy. It's, you know, how do these groups communicate? There isn't a formal hierarchy. There isn't a kind of a formal communications mechanism. The way these groups communicate, way open source insurgency, way an open source protest communicates is very similar to the way ants communicate through leaving chemical signatures, in this case, leaving information trails that then can be copied in an open source fashion. You copy whatever works. And that if you are the innovator, or the tinkerer, you're constantly innovating and throwing new concepts up, or new attack methods, new disruption methods up, to find which one actually achieves the desired effect. How do these movements fall apart? How do these insurgencies and protests fall apart? Typically, they fall apart when they succeed. When Mubarak leaves office, when Ricky left office, when the goal has been achieved, the plausible promise has been realized. Because at that moment, the protest or the insurgency, none of the component parts have anything that they can agree on. They're all at each other's throats at that moment. Another way it falls apart, and the way it did in Iraq, was through a hard fork. Zarqawi and the small group, the Al-Qaeda in Iraq, probably about 33% of the entire insurgency effort, decided to fork the insurgency by attacking the Golden Mosque and turning it into an anti-Shiite jihad. And at that moment, the entire insurgency forked. The Shia militias came through Baghdad and started ethnic cleansing in it, and the entire thing, the dynamic fell apart. So a hard fork can break an open source insurgency. Anyone want to, I'm going to move on to weaponized social networks. Anyone have any questions on open source insurgency?
Rain has a question.
Yeah, I was just wondering, what is it that makes them open source exactly? Like, I want to understand that connection a little better.
Okay. Well, there isn't any control over the strategy, the tactics, the methods. Anybody can contribute an innovation that then would be copied by the rest of the group. There's no source control. There's no hierarchy. There's no one saying, hey, we're going to be doing this. This is the only way that we're going to actually achieve this goal. If somebody comes up with something good and they demonstrate it, you have to demonstrate it in order to get it adopted, and it works, everybody copies it. And it meanders that way too, but the thing is that's the way it stays extraordinarily innovative. And in the case of IEDs in Iraq, whenever the US, $3 billion effort came in with a counter to an IED, within days, there were counters to the counters, and those counters, those innovations percolated out to the rest of the insurgency. They were moving so fast, and they were so innovative. They did what they did in the Irish Republican Army. It took them 20 years to do. They did it in about 6 months. So it's very, very different in that regard. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it sounds very mimetic.
Yep.
Thanks.
Jacob has a question.
Sure.
So what about in terms of the information sharing? Like, how is that, like, say somebody comes up with a good method, and how is that picked up by other groups? Is that like, because I know, I mean, there's not, are they like, I don't, I'm probably thinking they're not communicating through the internet, but that's probably
right.
Right. So,
can you
stop that by just like stopping the modes of communication? So that would possibly stop the movement?
Right. Well, early on, it was through cell phone and through the press. The press provided a conduit of information flow. So when the press covered an attack in Iraq, they basically demonstrated whether it succeeded or not. It was like, okay, here's the new target. Here's a target that appears to be vulnerable. Here's the method that they used to attack it. And here's the results. And it was all packaged in the stories that were published by the press. And that served as the kind of chemical trail for other people to copy, or other members of the insurgency to copy.
So did the Americans make an effort to control that, like to control the press?
No. In fact, they were operating according to the old rules. And you know, it took until 2006 and seven before a lot of the people who were running the counterinsurgency really tuned into what I was doing. But my stuff runs counter to a lot of the stuff that was available early on. They were anticipating a relatively hierarchical insurgency. And that's, you know, historically it's been the case. The insurgency mimics the state, you know, an out of power state, and it has an economic wing and a political wing and et cetera, military wing. And if you want to roll it up, you roll it up by flipping somebody at the bottom of the pyramid, and you work your way up and you get to that command element, that directory, you wipe them out, jail them, whatever, and the whole thing collapses. In this case, they would go up, find a little group, flip the bottom, and they go up about one level or two, and it just disappeared. And there were 70 other groups. So yeah, they didn't tune into that. And also everything was much more chaotic in terms of the number of different press outlets and people covering the conflict. You know, there were a lot of independents and people were out there generating news, and they were doing it from a variety of different angles. Nowadays, you know, as we're seeing is there's so many different outlets and methods of sharing information. You can do it on Twitter, you can do it on Facebook, you can do it in the press. All of this information is serving as a way to tune people into whether or not something works or not. And the cycles of actually acting on that new information are so fast, there's really not any way to actually censor it out in real time. At least right now. Over time, maybe we could develop AIs that snipe at that. But you know, that wipes out the effectiveness of protests against something that's actually bad too. So there's good and bad associated with that. Help.
There's a queue of three questions. Shall we get to those, or do you want to continue?
Let's push on. I mean, and then we'll you know, now we have some questions queued up, and we can revisit the different areas. I'll go into weaponized social networks, if you don't, guys don't mind. So we have the open source insurgency, the open source protest that was effective in challenging governments, challenging counterinsurgency forces around the world. In 2016, something changed, and it's primarily because of the way the United States was an early adopter of social networking. You know, I was involved in social networking since 2001, so, you know, I saw the growth rate and saw it pick up, and it changed us. It rewired us in the McLuhan sense. It rewired the way we think, and that change in the way we think, the way we communicate with each other, started to change the way we organize socially. Weaponized social networks are, you know, social groups that fight in the online environment. You know, the McLuhan's a global information war where there's no dividing line between the civilian and the military. In this case, it was in the political realm in 2016. Open source insurgency, fighting mostly in the mental maneuver realm, took over the Republican Party, used Trump as a weapon, held him aloft, because no matter what he did, as long as he was advancing the insurgency's cause, nothing could affect him and put him into office. So he could continue to detonate over 4 years. Some of the terms associated with this is that we have realms of conflict. Typically, there's three different places or realms that you can fight in. You can fight in the moral realm, you can fight in the mental realm, and you can fight in the physical. And the physical is attrition, okay? You wear down the opponent physically, make it physically impossible to fight. In the case of the online environment, that means disconnection, disconnecting you from being able to communicate online. We saw the big social networks primarily as using that technique to kind of tamp things down, to keep the status quo in place. The two dynamic groups were the resistance to Trump which fought mostly in the moral realm. And the moral realm is typically a guerrilla warfare concept. It wages war through creating, you know, uncertainty, menace, distrust, and that it alienate, which creates feelings of alienation, fear, and anxiety. In this case, it used shaming. It used establishing a moral consensus on an issue very quickly, and then and finding people who were in violation of that. It was very effective in doing that. The goal of fighting in the moral realm, fighting a guerrilla war like that, is to shrink the support for your opponent's center of gravity, the thing that holds it together, or shatter it and cleave it off, and forcing it to break into pieces while growing your own. That proved relatively effective, but not decisively so. The open source insurgency that took the White House operated in the mental realm through maneuver, through disruption. When you operate in the mental realm, it's like blitzkrieg. What blitzkrieg does is that it makes it impossible for the opposition to think clearly. You do that through fast maneuvers, lots of disruptions, something called fast transience, where you're moving from one thing to the next very quickly, and the motion within that, each action is very quick, making it impossible for the opposition to formulate any coherent thought. In the case of Blitzkrieg, it would be moving behind the enemy lines with a tank column and busting through towns and checkpoints and threatening command cells that are sitting in tents, 20, 30, 40, 50 miles behind the lines, and causing them to go nuts and think that they've lost everything and they're surrounded and everything is falling apart, which causes huge retreats and lots of disorder and disorganization. So these weaponized social networks were kind of dominated the discussion over the last 3 years. And things started to change in the last year, particularly with COVID. And COVID, accelerated everything, like every big disruption, every big, cataclysmic almost event, that it accelerated changes that were already underway. And now we see something more akin to network tribalization. So we're seeing a continuum from the open source to the weaponized social networks to tribes. And tribes are more cohesive, more coherent. We didn't see tribes earlier because there really wasn't a mechanism that hold the tribe together. Tribes are formed through a process of fictive kinship. This is how you get beyond blood relations. How do you get lots of people who aren't related by blood to operate cohesively? In the past, that was versions of tribalism that we have in the current world would be nationalism and the like. But in the online world, tribalization really wasn't possible because no one could agree on anything. And because, in an open source environment, everyone's has a different view of what they hope to achieve when the plausible promise is realized. So there's no agreement on what they are, who they are and why they should stay together and why they are better together. And that made tribalization almost impossible. In the case of say the anti-racist tribe, nobody can agree exactly what justice means. What does justice mean? If anyone comes up with an example of justice, they're always sniped at, they're attacked, it's turned on its head almost immediately. But the innovation here and what we saw in the last year is that people can agree on the patterns of behavior that they hate, what they dislike, what's a threat. And those patterns can serve as a mechanism for cohesion and tribe building. And we're seeing tribes develop around those patterns and that goes hand in hand with the kind of rewiring of our thought processes that have gone under we've been experiencing. We don't think in long form anymore. We don't read, you know, books or magazine articles in isolation as much, and formulate our opinions and then have reasoned discussions about those opinions. We pattern match. We sign on to a pattern that already exists, and we go around the internet and find bits and pieces of the information that's flowing past us. I mean, huge volumes of it are flowing past us, and then we match it to the patterns that we are curating. So here's a great example of this, and here's a great example of that. Oh, wow. You know, like, for instance, we just saw this with the mail problem with, where everyone's taking pictures from the past associated with mailboxes being picked up or shuttered or locked or disruptions in the mail, and they're posting online saying, you know, everything is falling apart. Here's another example of it. And a lot of those pictures are from 2015, 16. I mean, they're old. But it doesn't matter, because the pattern is what matters. And everyone can agree within that tribe that this pattern is an existential threat. Tribalization is, network tribalization is a kind of a big negative. I was hoping that we'd see network decision-making turn into something that was a positive for us, and that it could mobilize and create coherence at a level, at a speed that you couldn't do using traditional bureaucratic and market means. It did it with the early days of COVID. I mean, we acted in concert. We acted in March as a unit in terms of social isolation and working from home and instituting solutions. And that we could have developed over time a dynamic between that consensus seeking on very narrow issues and a dissent function that snipes at those, because you don't want those to overstay their welcome. But tribalization breaks that down. It locks things in. It creates these patterns of oppose, to root out, to find any examples down to the most minuscule and go after them. And we see them on the left, and we see them starting to grow on the right. But since they come out of moral warfare, it comes out of guerrilla warfare, it tend to be stronger on the left right now. But if the right gets out of power, they're going to start to tribalize. They'll start to use the same mechanisms. They'll go to guerrilla warfare. They won't have the disruptive bully pulpit of a Trump in place, able to run a maneuver, a disruption campaign, which is mostly emanating from there. And they will start to tribalize like we're seeing on the left. Some of the mechanisms in that, a lot of this is tied to empathy and the way empathy is used. We think of empathy as kind of a conscious thing where we extend our understanding of somebody else, their plight, their situation, and then we see that and we can appreciate it and take action as a result of it. But empathy is actually more of a communications mechanism. It's kind of a pre-verbal communications mechanism. It transfers a ton of information in a very short period of time. All you have to do is see something, see the outlines of something, and then your brain fills in the rest. It constructs the rest of the model. So what you're doing is, when you see somebody in danger, you mimic their mental model inside your own head, and you fill in a lot of the blanks. Your face, if grimaces, your eyes squint, your pulse races, you become them. And that empathy is really easy to use online. It's very effective online. Online actually is it very conducive to empathetic transfer and communication. We saw that with the George Floyd video. Is that video zoomed up, and it was the empathetic trigger that immediately changed the behavior and changed the way people thought across tens of millions, hundreds of millions of people. And empathetic triggers can cause a lot of change in a very short period of time. But the problem with empathy and the problem with tribalization is that it's always black and white. It becomes, you are for your tribe and you are empathetic to tribal members, but as a tribesman, you have zero empathy for the people outside your tribe. In fact, they're not even human in many respects. It's like Apocalypse Now with Kurtz, you know, trying to find the tribesmen that would do horrible things during the day fighting the enemy. And then they come home and be great family men and take care of their kids and have no worries or qualms about the whole entire process. Wouldn't bother them in the second. And tribalization, the thing that McLuhan always warned us about too, is that it creates that extreme, you know, hate of the other, of the group that's outside of the tribe. And we see that on the right, those attacks on the right that occurred where people go in and shoot up a church or shoot up a synagogue or go into a environment and cause havoc. If you read what those people have written, it's all empathetic. It's like, we are under attack. I have so much feeling for all of this and this and this. And these people unworthy of empathy, you know, are hurting us, are damaging us. And it's very tribal and it's very laden with empathetic language. So that's some of the terms. And, you know, my worry now is, you know, what I'm trying to, maybe we can discuss this next time, is where this goes in the next year or two. But I think in order to have a better discussion next Monday about, you know, where this ends up, you can dig into some of the terms right now and, you know, some of the concepts and get a better feel for those. So open it up to the questions.
Cool. Jacob, you had two questions, if you can unmute yourself and ask them.
Thanks. My first question was, what would be some examples from different protest movements you've seen of the system punks that they go after? And my second question was, if it feels like sort of like intuitively plausible to me, it's easier to like find stuff we agree we don't like than find stuff that we agree we like. And I was wondering why you think that's the case.
In protest movements, it's easier in insurgencies because the Iraqi insurgency and what we saw in Nigeria with Bend and others is that they disrupted energy infrastructure and corporate infrastructure, and that was extraordinarily effective in terms of driving support for different insurgent elements. Protests are tougher because you don't want to do as much physical damage potential chance of damage to individuals. But in this case, hitting roads, hitting downtown areas, occupying corporations, shutting them down, making it impossible for them to operate normally. And that puts an ongoing pressure, which has cascades of damage and disruption well beyond the initial event. We also see it in the online realm we see it with constant disruptive events that are chronicled and then, you know, shared among many, many people. And that could be a picture, that could be like the George Floyd video, you take an empathic trigger and you spread it. And that creates a disruptive event. It changes the way people think about things and they act on that. It doesn't always have to be in the physical space. It's much easier to actually spread disruption online. The help, and then the, why is it the case? One good explanation for why is the case that you can't agree on things is that we've moved, you know, Nietzsche and Heidegger, and everyone's really focused on this, is that we've moved from the metaphysical to the subjective. We create values and based on, you know, subjective experience. And those values vary based on individuals. I mean, every individual has their own value system. And the problem is that there's no agreement on exactly what those values are. And when you don't have the metaphysical as kind of the bedrock, the thing that doesn't change, what you have to do at the subjective level is make them absolute. That the values that you've created are absolute goods. And they're absolutely the only way to view the world. That gives it permanence, that gives it some kind of substance. And that if things are, if your values are absolute, the things that you're against, the values that clash with that are absolute evil. So you, what you have here is that the values that are absolute evil are easier to identify and get agreement on from all these people who have very, very specific views of what they consider good. And that's a kind of a philosophical backfilling on what's going on. Does that help?
Yes, that was very helpful.
So we have a lot of questions. We're probably not going to get to all of them, and I'm not going to pick them in order. But we have Paul. You had a few questions, and you had a recent one on open source insurgencies.
Yeah, hi, John.
Hi.
Hey, first of all, thanks for what you're doing. I'm in your Discord server and your live Google Doc, and it's a real thrill to watch you in real time.
Oh, thanks.
My question, the open source insurgencies that you're describing focus on a common enemy and then disrupt. This is a metaphor from software, and open source software is a creative process. It builds things. So my question is how can we extend the metaphor, I guess, and make it more generative? Is there something that we can learn from open source software movements, which are inherently creative and work towards a common goal of building something?
Right.
How can we learn from that to fuel the open source insurgencies that we're seeing in a more constructive direction?
Yeah, I've spent a decade trying to figure that out. and the only time I actually saw it in action, and it was potentially possible, is when we had that brief moment of consensus early on in COVID. And I thought, okay, wait a second. If something is, you know, narrow, like let's defeat COVID, that everyone can agree on, we can get amazing things done. But the problem was is that we didn't trust that network approach, even though that instituted most of the social distancing and work from home efforts early on in March, when the government didn't even have any data to operate on and to start doing the similar stuff or in terms of amplifying that, because we didn't have any testing because of the CDC, FDA problem. I mean, we only had 300 tests like in the nation at the beginning of March. It's like nothing, we didn't have any feedback loops. Now, if somebody was, you know, or a group of people had gotten onto YouTube and started assembling people and started the kind of decentralized effort to solve COVID as a kind of counter programming to what was going on in the White House and in all the state houses, in terms of finding out whether masks work early on when they were saying don't wear masks because they wanted to kind of do that noble lie to make sure that the first responders had masks. That they, you know, it, that we debunked that immediately and said, okay, wear masks. This is how you stay safe. This is how you get things done. These are the problems that we have to solve. I think we could have had that moment of building, that it would have been a constructive moment that demonstrated that this network decision-making system is a nice or effective and a needed complement to the kind of the tribalism bureaucracy and markets that we've used in the past, that we've perfected to a certain extent to get things done. And we lost that, we missed that opportunity. And now we're into a tribal phase where it's being used in a negative way. I mean, all of those old decision-making systems have been used horribly in the past, and particularly in the early stages. I mean, think of, you know, bureaucracy doesn't have any value system really associated with it. It's just effective at being efficient and mobilizing vast resources. And when it's used horribly, I mean, it can, you know, kills millions of people in concentration camps. It's a bureaucratic effort, the bureaucracy in action. We need the kind of this network decision-making system in order to solve these fast-moving, complex problems that we were faced with, whether it's a financial crisis or whether it's a terrorism incident or whether it's a pandemic or whether it's a global warming, whatever it is. but it has to stay narrow and it has to stay constructive. And we're not going to get that from the bureaucracy. You're not going to get that from the government. And we just haven't, we haven't tried it yet. We haven't, it doesn't come about that often, but it usually comes about in response to something big happening. Does that answer it?
Yeah, I mean, I think it answers it, but it's we still don't know, I think is the answer, yeah? I mean, we've seen some glimpses, but yeah.
Unfortunately, I mean, when the printing press emerged and the Universal Church started to disintegrate as a result of vernacular Bibles and leaflets everywhere, millions of leaflets pouring down, and the feudalism started to crumble as bureaucracy stood up in the early stages of the modern nation state, there were a ton of bloodshed in the 30 years war in Germany. But that thing, it was devastated. It was a very, very awful process. And I hope we can avoid that kind of thing. It's just that tribalism is at a network level is very, very dangerous, extraordinarily dangerous. Because the consensus function and this consensus dissent is the stronger function. Once it locks in, it can lock in forever.
Tyler, you had a question about moral warfare. Be a good follow-up.
Yes. So can overzealous moral warfare be redirected to backfire against those that are waging it? Not in terms of intergroup purity spirals, but in the public mind more generally, referring to cancel culture. I guess the paradox of it being viewed as immoral by the vast majority and only moral within the minority, but they use morality as an excuse to do it. Just trying to figure out how to resolve that.
Yeah, well, the moral warfare is being used as a mechanism for guerrilla warfare against an existing power, somebody who's in office. And it's being fueled by that. And I don't see any chinks in the armor right now. And I don't see that being, it's generating a huge amount of anger on the right. I see it underneath the surface. I see it in lots and lots of groups, and people who would normally be pretty even-handed, they react very strongly to any kind of excessive moralization, moral attack based on their DNA. And so, but that's unfocused, and it's not any kind of resistance to that puts you then in the Trump camp, right? In this case, in the existing paradigm. That may reverse if Trump is out of office. But again, you'll see more warfare on the other side.
Yeah, I guess.
And then it's not easily resolved. I don't see an easy way out of this. And if we go into the futures of next time, that's gonna be the crux of the discussion. Moral warfare is hard to unwind. Guerrilla warfare is hard to unwind. In worst case, it could be a multi-decade process. Once those patterns are in place, they're very hard to break up. They're very hard to disrupt because the people still parse their information in that direction, that way, and they do it as a group, and that's part of their identity. Is their the way that they parse that information? We could do it. And there is mechanisms to do it, maybe through changing the way the social AIs that the big networks operate. And you could do it very quickly, I think, using that mechanism. But I think a lot of the fight that we're having right now between the different groups is over who gets to set those standards. Who gets to set the goals for the training done on the big social AIs. Because once that's in, that happens behind the scenes. That's the opaque thing that actually turns society into a technological artifact. And whoever wins that early fight, how complex systems work, is that those early changes, those initial conditions, amplify over time. That work for you?
Yeah, thank you.
Yep.
All right, we have some good questions. Let's go with Tom and then Rain.
Tom Big Bang?
Yep.
Hi, this is Tom Big Bang from Toronto. love what you're saying. I find it quite scary. So I was wondering, what are the odds, what are the chances that the United States is going to end up in civil war? And what can your insights do to help avert that?
Okay. I don't think it's going to be a civil war in the traditional sense, where you have North and South or states dividing like that, where there's frontages and the like. It's more like a Yugoslavia or Rwanda, and maybe even lighter than that, where you have sporadic outbursts of violence, but it's used to advance the online war. So the online space is the center of gravity for the conflict, and that the violence is used as punctuation marks. To the degree that I think it's very likely we're going to have a lot more violence. That's almost guaranteed. I think, though, the U.S. is kind of serving as an incubator, not an incubator, but a kind of a, we're working out what an open system based on, you know, with network decision making can do and how it goes wrong. The world, you know, the free world to the large extent is going to be the beneficiaries of it. Of anything that we come up that actually works, I'm pretty negative in terms of the way things are going right now. I don't see either party wins the election. I don't see it changing much. The dynamics are pretty much locked in place. Elections are almost exogenous to the direction of the United States right now. It's a battleground. A lot of people see the elections as the ultimate. That is the thing that everything hinges on, and it doesn't. There's a larger tribal war here, at work here, and it'll bleed over borders. One thing we have with the network decision making is that it's not constrained by borders. It can go global, potentially. I mean, we have Facebook with 3.5 billion people. Even if it declines by a couple million people in the U.S., it's adding 500,000 people a day still. And a lot of places like the Philippines and others, that they get 100% of their news through Facebook and other online means. And these movements can become impossibly large. We could see billion-person movements or multi-billion-person movements. And if it tribalizes or there's a tribal element to it, it could be explosively bad.
Thanks, John.
Rain, you're up next.
There we go. Thank you, John. Really appreciating this so far. My question is about McCarthyism, but just to flesh it out a little, you said moral warfare is really hard to unwind. And that stuck with me and made me think, are there historical examples of the kind of tribalism and outrage politics that have dissolved? And you or anybody else on the call might have more knowledge of these historical cases of similar dynamics. And like, I'm curious how they dissolved and if we can learn from that, whether that's McCarthyism or going even back to the Salem witch trials, like that sort of othering and enemizing the intense tribalism that's conducted at an ideological level, not even necessarily a physical level. How does that dissolve, and do we have historical examples we can learn from?
Yeah, well, there's some uniqueness with this, is that it is based on patterns, online patterns, of what people hate versus what people are in favor of. And the difficulty is that those patterns exist out there, and there's a historical record of those, and people are constantly curating them, and their minds are locked into doing that curation. There are people who do this all day. That's all they do, is just scan the networks looking for examples, looking for ways to extend the pattern into new areas. But historically, I mean, you know, guerrilla warfare is a very, very hard nut to crack. You know, the old thing is like eating soup with a knife, right? it's John Nagel's old thing. It's like eating soup with a knife. It's very hard. There are inequalities and dynamics at work that keep on causing it to bubble up and just percolate forever. And it's, you know, since it doesn't, it's not defeated in a single decisive battle. It's a long-term changing of minds, and that's extraordinarily difficult to do. And I think it's extraordinarily difficult to do online too, because these patterns have a huge number of people supporting them. And these tribes that have formed around them are in every organization. You know, that we every institution has members, and you know, how you get rid of those, I don't know yet completely. I'm trying to figure it out as I go. You know, tribalization is really, really new. I didn't think that there would be a mechanism to get from open source to tribalism until I saw it in action, which is why I, you know, any kind of futurism I do is not based on just taking my theories and running them forward. Is I try to look for concrete examples, things that actually demonstrate that the theory I'm working on has some explanatory value, and that it has some predictive value. And I don't see them so much as like theories, I see them as frameworks for understanding. And even if they're wrong at some percentage level, they help you make decisions in an environment of high uncertainty. So, thanks.
All right, we have time for about one more question. I was going to call him Bill, but he seemed to just leave. Bill, do you want to ask your question now?
Sure. Thank you very much. Very interesting discussion. I appreciate it. As you commented, Peter, this is my first time at the Stoa. So, hi, everybody. My question was, you made some comments early on about the election in 2016 being an insurgency like this, like an open source insurgency. And that's the first time I've thought of it being organized per se. Like, I tend to think of the 2016 election being more a manipulative event. Basically, Trump just wanted to be president and finding a way to manipulate enough people into voting for him, as opposed to an organized insurgency. Like, if we think about Iraq, you know, although it's open source, there's a common goal of getting rid of, you know, the invaders, let's say. I'm not sure I see the analogy to 2016, if that's what you were implying, in the sense of a group wanting, you know, this president to be in power. It seemed to be more the opposite. The president wanted to be in power, and he found a way of manipulating the election and manipulating the environment to have that happen. And I just thought maybe you could comment on that.
Sure. There were precursors to what we saw, and with the financial crisis spawned Occupy, it spawned the Tea Party movement. Those were largely open source. There were rejections of the system, and that we saw a general rejection of the system that many, many people saw as killing them, and literally killing them in the sense that, or you know, figuratively, with the opioid crisis, it, you know, hitting all of those areas that were wiped out through sending manufacturing to China and the like. And you know, people were generally disgusted with, both on the left and the right, with the way things have been run. What Trump tapped into through his disruptive style is an open source insurgency. And it wasn't a group. It was many, many people with different views of why they were angry at the way things work. If you were watching this from more of the how the sausage was being made early on, you saw that the, you know, groups like the Donald, you know, with 300,000 people on Reddit. And I was interviewed on that prior to election in July, because people who were part of that were using my stuff. It's supposed to also, you know, Anonymous used my stuff. I guess they've told me that they used it in the creation of that group, which is kind of cool too, my earlier book. But Trump was interviewed like a week later, and he used that group as a test bed, and they developed the memetic kind of warfare that was being waged against Hillary. They took whatever he did and amplified it across the network. Whatever was done on Facebook with advertising was just a tiny, tiny thing compared to what hundreds of thousands of people were doing on Facebook and on Twitter and other venues to propagate messages. It's funny that after the fact that people thought it was actually, you know, being driven by some brilliant, Brad Parscale's manipulation of Facebook algorithms or something like that. I saw that as kind of, or maybe even Russian. If you watch the Russian manipulation, it was very ham-handed. Granted, it was part of it, but the volume of information, the volume of production, the volume of, the degree of innovation that I saw in all these other groups, and the number of people that were taking this and moving this forward, outside of those traditional ways of doing things, outside of the advertising, outside of the Russian internet research agency stuff, it dwarfed those. It was incredibly large and incredibly diverse and incredibly innovative. And the simple thing is that they weren't electing or pushing him forward as because of his traits or because of his, what made him effective as a candidate or a person. They put him in office as a weapon, as a disruptive one, is a disruptive attack. I mean, he was kind of an embodiment of the anger and the insurgency. They stuck him there. And that's why every single personal attack that occurred, everybody who told me, after the tape incident in the fall, that was the end of his, the Access Hollywood tape, so that was the end of his, candidacy. I said, it doesn't matter what personal traits he has or anything that's dirt on him. In an open source insurgency, they'll hold him aloft regardless, because he's not being put there because of that. He's advancing the insurgency's goals. And that Teflon nature, that ability to shrug off every kind of attack, and why he's still 41% support, is because he keeps on disrupting, keeps on breaking things, keeps on challenging and expressing anger. And that keeps him aloft. That help or not? I don't need to convince you. I just was saying this is my framework, and it seems to be predictive, and it works.
Yeah. So it feels, yes, on the anger, it feels so that the anger is it is open source. It's he's tapping into, by just being disruptive, he's tapping into a huge amount of anger that is in pockets. It's not focused in one direction. So for instance, he hasn't helped almost anybody who elected him except his, his rich buddies who got tax breaks, right? Like that's the obvious, those are the obvious winners. And when I say rich buddies, I mean, there's a lot of them because there's it's a wealthy country. The blue line workers, who are obsessed with Mexican immigrants and stuff like that. I mean, none of that's been, and the manufacturing economy and things like that have not fundamentally been helped by Trump. So
right.
It feels like a manipulation of anger for the anger's sake, not for any kind of agenda, that could be called cohesive.
You're exactly right. But he's the disruptive weapon. He's there. He keeps on disrupting. He's he's a grenade. He was put in the White House to break things, and he continues to do so. It's that achieving agenda items is the need of individual groups as part of the insurgency. But they're more angry at the system than they are angry that he's not doing stuff.
But by saying he was put, you're implying, from my perspective, a puppet master somewhere, hiding somewhere, as opposed to being elected simply because he's disruptive and everybody just wants to express anger, right? Like,
that's the goal of the insurgency. I mean, it's the only thing that seemed to keep them together and keep them cohesive. You know, if you wanted to look at this at a kind of an international scale and look at the two different models of how networks are being used outside the United States, you would have China at the consensus model, locking in through social credit system and Confucianism and trying to keep everything intact through greater and greater degrees of network control. And then you have the Putin model, which is more take a corrupt core through cross ownership, makes Putin the most richest guy in the world, probably $200 billion through all his cross ownership of all the different companies that make up Russia. And then he uses disruption on the network to keep everything roiling. Trump has never reached that level. He'd love to do that. It's pretty clear to me that he'd love to be doing exactly what Putin does. I mean, funding the opposition, getting everyone at each other's throats, and you'll never have any challenge to the 20-30% that actually supports him. But in the US system, it's too complex for that. And then what happens is that he is just rolling disruption, and that keeps his level of support up. And people are more angry at everyone else in the system and other groups that threaten them than they are angry at Trump for not delivering. It's a perpetual breakage machine in that regard. It's just, and it's being replaced now with tribalism. And we see this kind of tribal movement moving on the left, and it's growing very, very quickly. And that old status quo is not lasting.
All right, so I'm going to jump in here. We're past the hour mark. John, any kind of final thoughts to close this off? Like any idea of what the topic will be next week?
Yeah, we could project this off into the future and talk about potential futures and the role of AI in this. I think AI is going to play a critical role in some different views on what way AI actually manifests itself. I think there's a lot of misdirection. People are focused on the wrong thing and what it actually is and what it actually does to us. And you know, how things can go terribly wrong. Like my last report was all about, you know, the long night, you know, where the network becomes dominated and locked down and everything ceases. It's a civilization killer. Whatever tyranny we saw in the past is potentially much worse.
Very cool. Very cool. Okay.
So, I can stick on and just maybe chime in every once in a while, but you guys could talk. If you need me, just ping me. I'll just watch in the shadows.
cool.
Right.
So I'll do some closing announcements, then we'll stop recording. Then we'll break into groups and have about a 25-minute kind of post-sense making session. If you want to support John, check out his Global Griller Report, support the Stoa, or check out upcoming events for the Stoa. The links are there. John will, I think, post this video on his Patreon or something. And then this will eventually go up on the Stoa YouTube channel in October. Upcoming events for the Stoa, Tashin Fogelman's coming tonight at 6 p.m. Eastern time to talk about the art of alliances. Monastic at the Monastic Academy. And then tomorrow, James Karse, author of Finite Infinite Game, and John Vervaeke, famous UFT professor for the Awakening from the Meaning Crisis series, they're going to have a discussion playing the infinite game during the meaning crisis, which is going to be really awesome. That is tomorrow at 6 p.m. as well. So you can RSVP to those on the website. If you'd like to stick around for the sense-making session, we'll just do like a minute bio break, and then I'll split us up into groups of five. And we'll come back here after about 15 minutes of chatting together. We'll have a kind of a group discussion. So thank you so much for coming, and feel free to stick around.